Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Empire of the Romans, from Julius Caesar to Justinian, 600 Years of Peace and War, Volume 1, by John Matthews, narrated by David Stifel. Publisher's Note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and images present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and authors have used their best efforts in preparing this work, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work, and specifically disclaim all warranties, including without limitation, any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives, written sales materials, or promotional statements for this work. The fact that an organization, website, or product is referred to in this work as a citation and/or potential source of further information does not mean that the publisher and authors endorse the information or services the organization, website, or product may provide, or recommendations it may make. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering professional services. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a specialist where appropriate. Further, listeners should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is heard. Neither the publisher nor authors shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Preface. The appearance of yet another book on the Roman Empire invites a few words of explanation. Many good books exist already and keep appearing, rightly so, for it is a very good subject and an important one. The history of Rome makes up a substantial portion of the history of Western culture, and its linguistic, cultural, and legal influences persist. The span of time from the legendary foundation of Rome in 753 BCE to the death of the Emperor Justinian in 565 CE is not far short of that from the death of Justinian to the present day. An observation that has still more in its favor if one takes the date of the first Olympic Games in 776 BCE as the beginning of Greek, and so of Greco-Roman history. Admittedly, they took some time to converge. In some ways, this is a still more appropriate moment of definition, for it also marks the period of time in which the Greeks adopted the system of writing, the origin of our own, that would enable them to record their own history, and in due course that of the Romans, under whom many of their finest writers lived. This book takes as its starting point an event that is as much a part of Greek as of Roman history, as recorded by a Greek author writing under the Roman Empire, and moves on to the analyses offered by an earlier Greek historian on the Romans who were coming to dominate his world. And it ends with the descriptions given by the last classical Greek historian of Justinian's attempts to restore that Roman world as it had once been. The Romans had their own historians and their own ways of writing, but it is significant that a history of the Roman Empire can be framed by the writings of Greek observers of it. The Greeks were there first, and they were around for longer. The Roman Empire is also a time of which we have substantial knowledge, not such as to stand comparison with the mountains of documentation for the history of the modern world, but nevertheless incorporating evidence of many different sorts, physical as well as literate, permitting the recreation of a world of great sophistication and variety. It is a world that encourages different conceptions among those who write about it and their public, and that this public ranges far beyond the academic is evident from published lists of current and new books. One may still ask, what are the points of difference that mark a new book on such a well-established subject? The first question which faces the historian of any period is that of range. Where will it begin and end? As to the former, we should take for granted that any book on the Roman Empire will acknowledge the political and social antecedents of the Republican period. We must, however, be careful. The end of nearly half a millennium of Republican government in the first century BCE does not signal the end of res publica in its broader sense, that array of political, social, and legal institutions that belonged to the domain of public authority. However breached in the observance, the distinction between public authority and private power was one insisted upon by the founder of imperial government after the end of the civil wars that destroyed the Republic. Augustus and his successors may have expressed themselves differently as to what they had done with res publica, but none of them would have claimed its abolition. As late as 533, in publishing his Digest of Roman Law, Justinian referred to the emperor's duty, whenever an unexpected contingency might arise not covered by law, to correct and settle it and to subject it to suitable procedures and regulations, citing in support a famous jurist of the early 2nd century. There were tyrannical emperors, but the Roman Empire was not a tyranny. Whether a continuation of res publica in this broader sense was the only possible framework for a solution to the problems of the late Republic is an interesting question, but it was the solution that was adopted, and I have taken it to justify an introductory chapter on the political difficulties of the last 2 centuries BCE. There will be little here to surprise listeners familiar with the history of the late Republic. Nor have I tried to invent surprises, but a book on the Roman Empire would be incomplete without such an introduction to the system that it replaced. If all presentations of the Roman Empire will share an interest in the history of the Republic, there is more diversity to be found in their terminal points. How, when, and in what circumstances did the Roman Empire come to an end? This is a very large question, and it will cause no surprise to find a variety of answers to it. A process of disintegration will always be less orderly than a process of growth. It will be harder to describe, and will invite different points of emphasis, as the ancient sources themselves lose their sense of direction, and modern writers take different views as to what point the disintegration is reached, and whether what is left should count as Roman. There are also more prosaic reasons. I have heard of cases where a lecture course has come to an end simply because time has run out on the lecturer, as if the Roman world had declined and fallen for the convenience of the syllabus. Choices have to be made, but it is still worth noticing how the terminal point of a history may imply a judgment as to what is important. The decision to end a book on the Roman Empire with the beginnings of Diocletian's tetrarchy in the 280s may invite us to conclude that what follows is part of a different late Roman or even early medieval story, and medieval histories do often begin at this point. It is true that what follows in the 4th century shows important differences from what precedes, including a vastly increased scale of documentation on a far wider range of issues. Yet, it is not too much to say that the outcome of a generation's research on the later Roman period has been to show how the empire of the 4th century was more classical than medieval. Neither Ammianus Marcellinus, nor Claudian, nor Procopius, nor indeed Jerome or Augustine was a medieval writer. The Theodosian Code was a book of Roman law, while those political and social changes that make the later period seem so different from the earlier may also be understood as conditions for the survival of the Roman world and its culture. A book that ended with the death of Constantine in 337 might ask us to believe that a Christian empire is so at odds with the story of classical Rome as to require separate consideration, a choice that sets aside the fascinating story of how the classical and Christian elements in Constantine's empire responded to each other. To proceed further, a terminal point of 395 will reflect the idea that an empire divided between Eastern and Western governments is a new situation requiring a new treatment. But this does less than justice to the elements of an East-West distinction in the Roman Empire that had long existed, and in the second century had proved immensely fertile before it ever became a burden. Byzantine history has very deep roots in the classical world. The sack of Rome of 410 and the deposition of the last Roman emperor in 476 again offer defensible terminal points, based in these cases upon events of symbolic rather than substantive value. So too the execution of the Roman Boethius by Theodoric the Ostrogoth. These are all moments to stop for reflection, and for wondering what may be the shape of things to come. This book goes beyond all of them to end with the death of Justinian in 565, recognizing both that emperor's determination to restore the empire of the past and the work of the last truly classical historian, Procopius of Caesarea, in documenting the failure of the attempt. A good case could be made for continuing to the first Arab conquests in the Byzantine domains in the early 7th century, but at some point one has to leave it to someone else to carry on. The sensitivities and techniques of the classical historian are durable, but they do not last forever, and one's sense of the declining force of familiar methods of analysis is not a bad guide to the moment when the classical world has ended. Novelists sometimes remark that, once imagined, characters in a novel will choose for themselves what they do, what will happen to them, and how they will respond to it. In an odd sort of way, since his character's futures are already in the past, the same is true of the historian. Though without a novelist's freedom, the historian will have imagined his story in a certain way, and its characters will have chosen what will happen to them. Having found its logic, a book will tend to carry on as it is started, which is to say that its character will have become ingrained quite early in the process of composition. It will also reflect a number of more personal and subjective considerations, first among which is the nature of a historian's own past research, which will have provided familiarity with certain fields of study and types of source rather than others, and a corresponding sense of what is important. I have done my best to allow for these differences, but they will show. Style and manner are also a personal matter on which judgments have to be made. How to balance the detail with the flow of the narrative, the individual experience with the great movement, how to integrate narrative and digression, what level of detail is appropriate, how far to pursue the subplot. Excessive detail without context is tedious, but so in my experience are even the most profound generalities if they lack focus on the particular. I have attempted to tell the story continuously and to follow its changing features through transitions and across turning points that might otherwise divide it. What may at first appear as a challenge to the Roman Empire may in the end turn out to be what allows it to carry on. The Romans measured their history in centuries. The time of Augustus is as remote from that of Justinian as the Wars of the Roses are from us. And those wars were already a century old when Shakespeare wrote of the last of them, and they had a strong sense of an evolving history emerging from the past. It is a moment of surprise when Ammianus Marcellinus refers to Domitian and to the figure whom he styles Octavianus Augustus as emperors of olden times. until one realizes that he is looking back 300 and 400 years from his own day. The story unfolds through an interplay of narrative and digression. History is not timeless, and whatever the importance of the broader socio-economic and cultural issues at stake, and with whatever success they have been described, we do need to know where we are. The combination of approaches is accommodated in a rather large number of relatively compact chapters, grouped in sections to help bring out the shape of the argument as it moves forward. Yet this is not, considering its subject, an especially long book, and there has at all points been a question of selection with its surly companion, the omission of things that should have been included. I have often realized, in reading through drafts of its later chapters, that something should have been said earlier about topics that arise in them. There is a sense in which, in a society sufficiently conscious of its past to want to write about it, all history is concurrent, running together in the memory. The whole thing is in the mind, together. And one of the skills that the historian has to learn is how to present concurrent issues in sequence, to have them appear at the right moment. As Edward Gibbon understood, the future problems of the Roman Empire can already be seen in the Golden Age of the 2nd century. It is only in a Hollywood movie that one would actually put its fall in that period, but it is still appropriate, if it can be done without distraction, to mention at the moment of their earlier appearances matters that will become important later. It was Tacitus' habit to characterize upon their first appearance figures who would become important later in his history, a practice that certainly helps to sharpen one's expectations of the future. Finally, I have tried to give a sense of the primary material on which the story is based, and for this I need to say a few words about the companion volume of this book. Volume 2, Select Anthology, offers a complementary selection of texts running in parallel with the main divisions of the present volume, chosen also to broaden its range, and able, with its introductions and commentaries, to be used as a freestanding work. It will sometimes document something said in the present volume, but more often will offer a broader, sometimes more subjective impression, or offer a shift of viewpoint, as one might say, from the makers of history to the users of it. I try in the anthology to balance texts of different types, literary authors with documentary, legal, and epigraphic materials, papyrus records, letters, and so on, with a special interest in texts that express themselves in the first person or reflect individual experiences. I pay relatively little attention to standard historians such as Tacitus or Suetonius or Ammianus Marcellinus, not because I do not respect these writers, a 600-page book on one of them should be sufficient proof of that, but because they are available in inexpensive modern translations with excellent introductions. And also because once an ancient historian gets at his material, he is no longer a primary source in the strict sense, but an observer with an opinion. I have chosen extracts from historians only when they have some personal or other particular relationship to the events they describe. John Matthews, New Haven, Connecticut, June 2020. Part 1. Building an Empire. Chapter 1. Introduction. The Roman Republic and its Discontents. The Greeks, after their country had been reduced into a province, imputed the triumphs of Rome not to the merit, but to the fortune of the Republic. A wiser Greek, who has composed with a philosophic spirit the memorable history of his own times, deprived his countrymen of this vain and elusive comfort by opening to their view the deep foundations of the greatness of Rome. Gibbon, Decline and Fall. For those who were there, whether Greek or Roman, it was a formative moment when the consul Titus Quinctius Flamininus followed up his defeat of Philip V of Macedon at Cynoscephali with a proclamation of freedom for Hellas. The occasion, at the Isthmian Games of 196 BCE, is described by Plutarch. After the trumpet had signaled for all to be silent, the herald came out before the assembly and proclaimed that the Roman Senate and Titus Quinctius Flamininus, consul in general, having defeated King Philip and the Macedonians, granted freedom without garrisons or taxes, and the enjoyment of their ancient laws to the Corinthians, Locrians, Phocians, Euboeans, Achaeans of Phaeotis, Magnesians, Thessalians, and Perhebians. At first, says Plutarch, the proclamation was not heard clearly, but when it was repeated more loudly, a shout of joy arose, so loud that it reached the sea. The whole audience rose to its feet and paid no attention to the competing athletes. Everyone was eager to press forward to greet and hail the savior and champion of Hellas. So mighty the clamor that the air was torn asunder, and ravens flying over the stadium fell to the ground. Flamininus' proclamation, made on behalf of himself and the Roman Senate, is a classic example of the uses of history in the service of politics. In declaring the end of Macedonian tyranny, it echoed the great debates that we know from 4th century Athens, as Demosthenes warned of the dangers to freedom presented by the rise of the first great Macedonian king, Philip I. Those events were not so very far distant. 150 years is not much in the long durée of history. But in the meantime, the reign of Philip's son Alexander had changed beyond recognition the shape of East Mediterranean politics. Whether or not they realized or wanted it, the Romans were themselves the heirs of Macedon. Their influence in mainland Greece continued to expand and to be resisted, its true nature made apparent by their victory at the Battle of Pydna in 168, and the end of the so-called Third Macedonian War. After the battle, the Romans dispatched to Italy 1,000 of those unfriendly leaders of Achaean cities who had supported Macedon, ostensibly to await trial, but in effect as hostages for their city's good behavior. Installed in various Italian towns, they were left largely to their own devices. After 15 years, 700 of them had died. Many of them, leaders of their cities, must have been elderly to start with. The rest were released, but their return home, somewhat bearing out the Romans' caution in detaining them, inspired a revolt of the Achaeans, and in 146 the sacking of Corinth, their capital city. It was another formative moment, for the sack of Corinth was in the same year as the destruction of Carthage in what is blandly called the Third Punic War, but was provoked by the Romans specifically to secure this outcome. The power of Carthage had been destroyed in 201, and with the defeat 10 years earlier of the great Sicilian city of Syracuse, Rome was now indisputably the greatest power in the central and western Mediterranean. Her treatment of the defeated Macedonians and Achaeans also gave her a fair claim to be the most ruthless. It was said that in Epirus, 70 cities were destroyed and 150,000 prisoners sold as slaves. But this was how wars ended. The aftermath of the Trojan War, as described by Odysseus to his Phaeacian hosts, was the same. And if that example belongs to the realm of legend, there is an indubitably historical parallel in Thucydides. The town now being strongly besieged, there being also some that practiced to have it given up, they yielded themselves to the discretion of the Athenians, who slew all the men of military age, made slaves of the women and children, and inhabited the place with a colony sent thither afterwards of 500 men of their own. There were differences in the scale and consequences of these events. In a sort of moral retribution for their conduct in Milos, The power of the Athenians, beginning with the very next sentence on Thucydides, was soon to be destroyed in Sicily, while the Romans, by that indomitable combination of virtue and fortune on which they prided themselves, became ever more powerful. Among the Achaean hostages sent to Italy after Pydna was the man who became the author of what is by far the most penetrating analysis of the history of this period. This was Polybius of Megalopolis, about 200 to 118, whose father had been a leading figure in the Achaean Confederacy. Polybius was allowed to live in Rome, where he won highly placed friendships, especially with Scipio Aemilianus, grandson of Scipio Africanus, the victor in the Second Great Punic War of 218 to 201. He was with Aemilianus to witness the destruction of Carthage in 146. To whom else could the Romans entrust this task than to a descendant of Hannibal's conqueror? Polybius was a Hellenistic intellectual, with versatile gifts and an acerbic polemical tone when discussing his literary rivals. In a startling initiative, he was lent some ships by Aemilianus and followed the African coast past the Straits of Gibraltar to the Atlantic. He was with Scipio in Spain, and an enterprise that is the envy of modern antiquarian scholarship traced Hannibal's invasion route over the Alps. Interested in geography and an explorer, he wrote a book on the habitability of the equatorial regions. Polybius was a man of thought and action, such as the Romans liked, a political leader as well as an intellectual. Polybius' most famous work, and the only one to survive even in part, is his history in 40 books, its subject the rise of Rome from the Second Punic War to the Battle of Pydna, the moment when Rome's expansion seemed to demand from the Greeks an understanding of their antagonists. Its purpose can be seen in two ways, one a mirror image of the other, as an attempt to explain Rome to Greek readers and to explain the Romans to themselves, as an educated Greek saw them in the context of Greek political thinking. It was not the first history of Rome to be written, for that had been done by the Roman Fabius Pictor, also writing in Greek, in Polybius' early lifetime. Polybius, however, wrote from a standpoint refined through generations of historical writing and philosophy. The idea of history as containing recurrent patterns with a predictive value, a process subject to general interpretation. It is not so much that history repeats itself, but that similar events recur over time, and that one can learn from experience, a historian's task being to find the levels of analysis at which these patterns can be found, and to present the result for the instruction of those who would read it as a lesson for their own times. Polybius attributed Roman success to a combination of factors: the loyalty of her allies, which gave her unparalleled resources of manpower, her practical inventiveness, her willingness to learn from experience, her military organization, the disciplines imposed by her religion. He especially noted what he called her restraint in internal politics, meaning that unlike other states, Rome was not disturbed by revolution brought on by external events. As for example, the Athenian defeat in Sicily brought on the oligarchic revolutions of 411. He supported this view by adducing a theory of the Roman constitution deriving from Greek philosophical discussion as we know it from Plato and Aristotle, but which in Polybius' experience was much more widely current. The essential idea was that constitutions, what Greeks called politiai, a word for which Romans had no exact equivalent, though it yields the English polity, experience a cycle of changes, in a pattern of external and internal transformations. Polybius argued his case from first principles. In the beginning is one, a state of primeval chaos which issues into a monarchy or kingship as some great man seizes control to impose order. After a time, 2, kingship declines into tyranny, which in turn, 3, is replaced by aristocracy, when the best men deposed the tyrant through outrage at his conduct. The next stages come about when 4, aristocracy degrades into oligarchy, the rule of the best declining into the rule of the few, without maintaining the same standards of integrity. And 5, when the people take power in a democracy. In due course, 6, democracy declines into ochlocracy, or the rule of the mob, Greek ochios. And 7, ochlocracy declines into chaos, setting off the return of the cycle. Each form of government is transformed into its less desirable version, which is then deposed by discontented elements in the state, progressively becoming more and more democratic and beyond that point, as each phase self-destructs into the next. It is a schematic account, though realistic at certain moments. The fall of the monarchy at Rome could well be characterized as a transition from a discredited tyranny to an aristocracy, for no one should run off with the idea that the original Roman Republic was a democratic institution. It is also a predictive model. By identifying the point of the cycle reached by any particular politeiae, it would be possible to anticipate the next stage. But Polybius was not predicting the decline of Rome, and he introduces a new element to break the inexorable cycle he has described. This is the idea of the mixed constitution, examples of which Polybius found at Sparta and at Rome. In such cases, the politeiae does not process from better to worse in a spiral of decline, but all elements, aristocratic and democratic, reconcile their differences and work in harmony for the good of the community. The theory of a mixed constitution has a fashionable origin in Thucydides' description of the Athenian constitution of the 5000, which briefly held power after the oligarchy of 411, as a mixture, synkrasis, of the interests of the many and the few. The idea appeals both to a philosophical instinct for moderation and to a conservative claim to broad-mindedness, but it is fallacious. The moderate constitution of the 5000 included the few who had taken part in the oligarchic regime preceding it, but it excluded the many who had formed the democracy that they both replaced. How could it then be a mixture of these two components? It is important to distinguish the idea of a mixed form from that of a balanced constitution. The first, an ideal situation in which all interests are accommodated by a proportionate representation of the parties, is not the same as one in which the sectional interests of a society remain but are balanced by constitutional restraints. At Rome, there were many such restraints. Magistrates were elected to colleges in which each magistrate possessed a veto, the right of intercession over his colleagues of equal rank. And tribunes, the people's magistrates, could exercise an intercessio to defend the people's interests against the actions of any other magistrates. And there were other checks and balances designed to prevent abuse, and to avert the danger of monarchy arising from the power and prestige of any individual. Polybius was unduly optimistic about the restraining effects of this system. As the future would show, the restraints were potentially negative in effect, producing not collaborative action, but stalemate, and violence when the obstructions became impossible for one party or another to tolerate. What most threatens Polybius' judgment is that the Roman political system was driven not so much by compromise as by competition, by family pride and claims of ancestry, one's standing among clients and dependents, summed up in the word dignity, dignitas, or what one is worth, a concept covering much more than the modern idea of personal deportment, rather one's entire social, political, and individual standing. The aspiring senator needs to win the consulship, the highest magistracy, to maintain the status of his family, or in the case of a new man from a non-senatorial background, to establish it as part of the nobilitas. It does not matter so much what a man does in office, so long as he can avoid prosecution for maladministration. And if this occurred, he can expect his senatorial peers to rally round in his defense, in case someday they too were impeached and needed his support. It is a dangerous mixture of ingredients, especially with the acquisition of overseas possessions and the influx of foreign wealth. It was the habit of those contending for high office to incur debt to win election. And its corollary, the need to recoup one's electoral expenses, generated mismanagement and corruption. Meanwhile, the price of competition rose, with immense wealth pouring into Rome from its newly acquired overseas territories. Polybius' interpretation is a classic example of a theory succumbing to the force of events. Within 10 years of his writing, and still within his own lifetime, his image of a stable Roman society saved from revolution by its institutions was shattered. There are several issues which his balanced constitution failed to contain. The agrarian problem in Italy, the Roman citizenship, the question of the provinces, and war, the army, and the nature of power. I will take them in turn and as briefly as possible. It will be obvious that they interlock at many points. The idea is not to explore these issues in their own right, but to show how in their various ways they exposed the institutional weaknesses of the Roman res publica and invited the creation of a remedy. We need first to recall what has been happening during the century before Polybius' mature lifetime. Sustained war, with all its consequences for manpower and economic growth, against Carthage, Macedon, and in Spain, where Rome was engaged after the Punic Wars until the fall of Numantia in 133 BCE. To judge by the recorded census figures, manpower losses in the Second Punic War of 218 to 201 were substantial, with a decline from 214,000 Roman citizens in 203 to 144,000 10 years later, or on a different basis of estimation, from 240,000 to 183,000, repeating an equally distinctive pattern of loss at the time of the First Punic War of 264 to 241. In both cases, the figures reflect both casualties in war and the ensuing decline in the reproductive capacity of society. We must add the economic losses entailed in long absences of citizens from their lands, as they were summoned to serve in the wars. The consequences of these factors were neglect, foreclosures and bankruptcies, abandoned farms and their seizure by more powerful neighbors and creditors. There were settlements of discharged soldiers on confiscated public land, such as that taken from Capua in retribution for its support of Hannibal. But much of this was usurped by powerful families, who turned it over, or let it lapse, from agriculture to unsupervised pasturage. This caused further insecurity, shepherds being next to bandits as they herd flocks between hill and plain and find shelter and support where they can. Another disruptive factor was the growth of slavery from the wars. Many of the captives were put to work as agricultural slaves in appalling living conditions, creating the threat of slave wars, such as broke out in Sicily in 136 to 131, and 60 years later in Italy. The challenges to the social order inherent in these conditions led to the reform attempts of the brothers, Tiberius and Gaius Gracchus. From a family of the high nobility, connected through their mother with the Scipios, the Gracchi are a paradigm of the link that, whether through enlightenment or desperation, one may find between aristocratic background and reforming tendencies. Tiberius Gracchus served under Scipio Aemilianus at Carthage in 146 BCE. It is interesting to think that he was there with Polybius, and at Numantia in 137. A story is told that he had observed the results of depopulation while traveling to Spain to serve there, presumably by a route through northern Italy. In any case, the problems were not confined to the south. Elected tribune of the people as a young senator in 133, Tiberius Gracchus introduced forward legislation on land reform, beginning with the recovery of public land. This was to be achieved by a combination of expulsions, when illegal occupation could be demonstrated, and buying out when it could not. A land commission was appointed to supervise the work, to be funded from the estate of the recently deceased King Attalus III of Pergamum, a connection that goes back to Rome's friendship with his grandfather Attalus I at the time of Macedonian Wars. When Attalus III died in 133, having no heirs of the line, he bequeathed his kingdom to Rome. This legally challenging situation, under whose law was the bequest made, would not mean that Rome gained unrestrained possession of all his property, but that she accepted the inheritance with whatever obligations might be attached to it, such as the payment of debts and bequests to individual legatees. If Attalus had named as his heirs the Roman Senate and people, and whom else could he name, this immediately thrust the question of the ownership and use of the proceeds into the heart of the conflict that was now developing, against Polybius' predictions, between Senate and people. Which was the sovereign body? When an alternative proposal was put forward, to spend the bequest on public distributions that would increase the popularity of the senators who voted it, Tiberius Gracchus challenged the claims of the Senate to authority and took his proposal straight to the popular assembly known as the Concilium Plebis. This was a politically charged move, but legitimate and rooted in the distant past. The Concilium Plebis was not a feature of the original Republican Constitution, but had come into being shortly afterwards, in the rebellion against that Constitution known as the Secession of the People, conventionally dated to 494 BCE. The people had withdrawn from Rome to the Aventine Hill, which at that time lay outside the city, and had established its own assembly and its own magistrates, the tribunes, who quickly acquired diverse rights as the people's champions. Long denied legal force, the resolutions of the assembly known as decisions of the plebs or plebiscites, plebiscita, had more than a century before the time of the Gracchi acquired the same legal authority as those of the tribal assembly of the original constitution. In the Concilium Plebis, Gracchus the tribune was on home territory, but the Senate took him on by planting another tribune to veto the legislation. The people responded by deposing the hostile tribune from office, probably the first action in this sequence of events that was definitely illegal, though one can make the case for it. Gracchus then stood for a second tribunate, which if not illegal was certainly irregular, but before holding it was killed by a senatorial posse, led by, of all people, the Pontifex Maximus. Not only was this action illegal by any measure, it was a violation of the religious protection, sacrosanctitas, attaching to the figure of a tribune. Gracchus' killers had committed an act of sacrilege. They had also defined the issue as one of Senate against people, and set a pattern of violence to be repeated in the years that followed. The issue of the Roman citizenship came to a head under Tiberius' younger brother, C. Gracchus, who was elected tribune in 123-2 BCE and again in 122-1, and brought in a major program of legislation. From the beginning, the Romans had been far more generous than the Greeks in extending the citizenship to those whom they conquered. Not that this was entirely based on idealism, for it was on their inclusive policies that an expanding Rome had built its manpower resources, as the communities that received the citizenship also acquired military obligations and shared in the benefits of the further wars they made possible. Over the years, however, this policy too had begun to be a cause of dissension between popular and aristocratic institutions, and between Rome and the Allies. The citizenship brought political and legal benefits, including rights of intermarriage and the vote, and protections against exploitation. However, new voters disturbed the status quo, reduced the influence of the original citizen population, and their voting behavior might tend to favor the Roman magistrates who had won them the citizenship, which also attracted immigrants to an increasingly overcrowded city. At the same time, Roman policies towards their Italian allies were becoming more restrictive. Aspiring citizens who were excluded resented it, while at the same time, some of those who had been admitted felt exploited, with all those wars to fight, ever further from their homes. Gaius Gracchus revived a proposal to extend the citizenship to all Italians, and proposed founding colonies at Carthage, Capua, and Tarentum. However, the citizenship bill was defeated, as existing citizens defended their rights, and the colony at Carthage was abandoned on religious grounds. After their destruction of the city, the Romans had sworn never to allow the site to be repopulated, and had spread salt on its fields to make them uncultivatable. The effects of the salt would wear off as it leached away, but the oath remained a formidable obstacle to resettlement. Gaius Gracchus also introduced a grain law, Lex Frumentaria, to secure state-purchased grain, to be made available at a rate subsidized below the market price. But this too was a divisive issue, for it was only citizens fully resident at Rome who enjoyed the entitlement. Like his brother, Gaius Gracchus died in a counter-revolution. The Senate had passed what it styled the ultimate decree, Senatus Consortium Ultimum, to protect the state from danger, a procedure with no legal authority except the Senate's self-appointed role as the guardian of the Constitution. Italian resentment at the withholding of the citizenship led to the social, in the sense of allied, wars of 91-83, which were brought to an end by the granting of it. Even then, the Senate engaged in gerrymandering to exclude the new citizens from their legitimate rights. An ever-present factor in these events was the growth of the city of Rome itself as an urban community, as a rapidly enlarging population challenged a divided government's ability to maintain order and tranquility. With a population perhaps already rising towards 1 million, the city was behind its times in looking after their needs. In such matters, cities like Alexandria and Antioch were far in advance. Without any substantial improvements to its physical amenities, the safety and living conditions of the city were constantly exposed to the dangers of fire, floods from the Tiber, polluted water, and pestilence, afflictions reported only sporadically in our historical sources, but a constant cause of misery. The last of them, pestilence, is powerfully illustrated by the mass grave that came to light in 1876 at the huge cemetery on the Esquiline, just outside the Servian walls, when the foundations of a new construction fell into the void left by the decomposed bodies. It was measured as 160 feet long by 100 feet wide and 30 feet deep, and estimated by its excavator, Rodolfo Lanciani, to have contained the astonishing number of 24,000 corpses. The result, in Lanciani's opinion, of a single epidemic, totally undocumented in our written sources. As to normal practice, the bodies of slaves and the very poor were disposed of by burning or dumping, or thrown with other refuse into the unmarked pits, again outside the Esquiline Gate, known to Varro and the grammarian Festus as puticuli, many of which have been found, and their typical measurements established. With surface dimensions of 5 by 4 meters and a depth of 10 meters, these are seriously disturbing monuments of the funerary history of Rome, and by extension, of living conditions in the Republican city. No wonder that the poet Horace, supported by his ancient commentators, could write of the area as strewn with the bones of the dead, where witches might gather to summon up their spirits. That was before the area was acquired by Augustus' supporter Maecenas and converted into pleasure gardens, which gives Horace the opportunity to cite its overall dimensions as 1,000 by 300 feet, poetically imprecise, no doubt, but giving us a sense of the scale of it. As to the provinces, there are three overriding questions. First, the rudimentary system of government Rome applied to them. Senatorial governors, known as praetors, were sometimes appointed, and magistracies occasionally prolonged to permit continuity of government, but there was no system of what were later known as proconsular positions. That is to say, regular appointments held in provinces in place of the consul. Rome was improvising a system of government without wanting to disrupt the established systems of promotion to the Roman magistracies or to change the nature of the magistracies, which remained rigorously annual. The provinces were acquired piecemeal and without an overall plan. Macedonia was acquired after the Macedonian Wars, with which this chapter began, while Asia Minor fell to Rome by the will of Attalus III of Pergamum. Narbonensis, the original provincia that still gives its name to Provence, was established in 121 BCE, in a moment of opportunism that Polybius would have admired. It combined a campaign against Gallic tribes, undertaken in concert with Massilia, Marseille, Rome's oldest ally in the west, with the securing of the land route to Spain. The colony that gave its name to the province, Narbo, modern Narbonne, was founded in 118. Newly acquired territories were taxed, but under what legal definition is not clear. Was it tribute in the form of indemnity payments or reparations after war, as might be said of Carthage in 202? Or was it, an extraordinary theory advanced by Cicero, rent paid by provincials for the continued occupation of land now owned by Rome? If there was reciprocity of benefits given for taxes paid, it was not made explicit. In the Athenian empires of the 5th and 4th centuries, a supposition was maintained that the tribute, styled foros in the First Empire, eisphora in the Second, was for services rendered in commerce and common defense, but no such rationale was offered by Rome, unless it was the provincial's betterment through involvement in Rome's expansion. The tribute was exacted by contractors, publicani, who bid for the right to collect the taxes, and recouped their expenditure as they did so. The result was that the res publica got its money at the start of the process, with no further incentive to intervene, while the publicani, effectively unsupervised, could look for their profits by the end of it. This was a royal road to extortion, restrained only by a legal process that was difficult to access, since it had to be pursued at Rome, where the contractors and their friends, including predatory senators, could gang up and obstruct the legal process. At the formal levels of government, too, there was notorious corruption, extortion, and abuse, not to mention the ransacking of provinces for anything of value. Cicero, as governor of Cilicia, made it a point of pride that he had not confiscated works of art for his own enjoyment. He had made his own reputation as an orator by prosecuting the proconsul C. Verres for maladministration in Sicily. Verres was patently guilty, but there was a precedent for the theft and importation of provincial treasures, in L. Mummius' ransacking of Corinth in 146 BCE. The destruction of Corinth and Carthage and the siege of Numantia were followed by a generation of relative peace, but in the last decades of the century, the limits of Roman power were tested by successive wars. The Jugurthine War in Africa, 111-106, arising from the disputed inheritance of a Moorish prince, and in a new phase of migration of northern peoples, Teutonic and Celtic invasions of Italy, 107-101. The wars were prolonged, and they required new forms of recruitment and structures of command. The response to these needs created a new estate in Roman society and new players in Roman politics, the army and its generals. By the late 2nd century BCE, the effectiveness of the traditional citizen army had reached its limit. As we have just seen, the burden of service fell heavily upon the contributing Italians, not only through losses of manpower in warfare and by attrition, but through the damage to the agricultural economy caused by absence and neglect. There was also growing resentment among the allies, as Rome began to deny them citizenship and its benefits began to seem more dubious. Polybius claimed that they fought willingly against Hannibal would not have been as true a century later. There were also the strategic limitations of a citizen army, as serving soldiers were released for the harvest. As in the wars described by Thucydides, campaigning was limited by the agricultural seasons, with obvious difficulties for the more continuous military operations that might be necessary in overseas theaters of war. The Romans also lacked a structure of command adapted for the demands of prolonged campaigning. The powers of magistracies were confined to the year in which they were held, but the consequence of this, frequent changes of command as magistrate succeeded magistrate, was to deprive campaigns of continuity and the benefits of experience. It was necessary for C. Marius, the Roman commander in the Jugurthine and the Teutonic Wars, to hold 5 successive consulships in order to build up a strategic advantage. This was not the best way to secure continuity of command, nor was it what was intended for the consulship. Marius followed his victories in Africa by the wars against the Cimbri and Teutons in North Italy and Southern Gaul. The essence of the reform by which he achieved his successes was in the recruiting of a fully professional paid army, replacing the citizen army based on the ancient property classes defined in the constitutional settlements of the 6th century. Marius extended the opportunity of service to any person who offered himself, on the strict basis of his fitness as a soldier. Such men, styled capiti quinci, because they had no property but only their person, caput to declare, had previously been enrolled in crises such as the Hannibalic War, but were now made the basis of a full-time professional army, serving winter and summer alike. Despite the absence of a property requirement, however, it was still necessary to be a citizen to be accepted for service, for which the regular term either was, or soon became, 15 years. The stipend was enhanced by incentives in the form of booty. Success was rewarded by bonuses. The soldiers were equipped for practical use, carrying not only standard weapons, shield, sword, pike, but also a shovel for digging in fortifications, essential for defense and consolidating the results of a campaign. The descendants of Marius' mules appear on the reliefs of Trajan's column at Rome, where soldiers are seen digging in fortifications and building camps, as well as killing the enemy and standing in parade. With these and other reforms, soldiering became a viable full-time career, offering a steady income and the chance of a stable retirement. One price to pay was deracination, as soldiers were required to serve in many regions and might be settled in military colonies far from their land of origin. Family life is a regular victim of a professional army, in which men are removed from the home country and are often away from base. On the other hand, a young man recruited at 18, who handled himself well and survived military action, might find himself settled as a small farmer at well under 40, after a career whose usefulness none would doubt. It was enough to attract many to the service. For all the nostalgia of conservative commentators, there is no doubt that the new one was better trained and more effective in meeting the military needs of the time. Marius' military reform was not in itself a political act, but it had immense political consequences. The new model army emerges as a political force, a new estate in the realm. Without anticipating too much, we can see how this came about, as the new recruits, without any census qualification or interest in property in the land, are not beholden to the social order, and have no incentive to uphold it. They profit from their commander's success in war, and depend on their ability to deliver their promises through political influence. But the generals were not always able to do this, even with the authority of success in the field. Their proposals fell foul of hostile rivals and a suspicious Senate, and there were many ways of obstructing them. This generated hostility between the soldiers and the Senate, and exposed the generals between the two. There is also a new dynamic for imperial expansion. Soldiers need the economic benefits of campaigning, and generals need the prestige of victories to advance their careers and to satisfy their promises. But there is no overall conception of the proper size of the army, based on the consideration of public policy by a well-informed sovereign body. Generals could raise armies in the field for specific purposes, with no one to say how large the military establishment should be, for no one had a very clear idea of what it was for. That hallowed Roman tradition, belligerency, was driven by economic and political pressures, with no clearly defined purpose. And finally, the most intractable issue was the search for new forms of command to match the changing needs of Rome and its army. Something more coherent was needed than annual magistracies and pro-magistracies, which lapsed with the offices, or were given only for short periods and according to no consistent criteria. The implications of this quandary are revealed by the careers of three of the men of power, what Appian called the dynasts of the late Republic: Marius, Sulla, Pompey. The case of Marius has already arisen. Consul in 107 BCE to command in the Jugurthine War, he held the office again every year from 104 until 100 to conduct the wars against the Cimbri and Teutons. To hold five consulships without a break is a contradiction of what was intended by the founders of the Roman Republic. The supreme magistracy, designed to avert kingship, was to be held once only, always with a colleague. It was never intended as a vehicle of extended power, indeed, rather to prevent it. In 100, in a first test of the procedure set up for his new model army, Marius sought land settlements for his veterans of the Teutonic Wars through legislation brought forward by the tribune Saturninus. But in a confusing subplot, Saturninus disrupted the situation by managing the assassination of a former tribune, a political rival of his own. In a startling volte-face, Marius responded to the Senate's appeal under the device of the Senatus Consultum Ultimum, the ultimate decree to defend the res publica from harm, as we have seen it used against Gaius Gracchus. Marius' men surrounded Saturninus on the Capitol, and the tribune surrendered but was slain by a hostile mob, an act of sacrilege in which Marius was implicated. He then went east to fulfill a vow, as he claimed, but in effect to take himself off the scene. After some years' absence, he returned to take a leading role in the social wars of 91 to 89. He then sought the command against a new eastern adversary, King Mithridates of Pontus. The command was, however, given to L. Cornelius Sulla, and when it was taken from him in favor of Marius, Sulla got it back by the practical expedient of marching on Rome with the army already assigned to him and demanding it. In Sulla's absence, Marius made yet another comeback and became consul for the seventh time in 86. He died a few days into his tenure of the office. The political legacy of Marius is confusing, partly because it was in advance of his time, or because he himself was shaping the future, and also because his reputation was traduced by his enemies. Like his younger compatriot Cicero, both were from the Italian town of Arpinum, Marius was a new man, novus homo, the first senator in his family. It was not usual for such men to rise to the consulship, and Marius had done so seven times. He was energetic, a good general, and his military reforms show great insight. If he lacked subtlety, it is perhaps because he did not think it an important virtue, or did not perceive the rules of the game he was inventing. But he was obstructed, and no doubt as a novus homo, excluded from his due reward by a jealous Senate. He was much feared as a popular leader against the oligarchy of the Senate, and his name, transformed into the Marian or popular faction, survived his death. Sulla, clever, subtle, disconcerting, is utterly different. His early career was much entangled with that of Marius. We have just seen how in 88 he was given the command against Mithridates, but was then deprived of it and won it back by just marching on Rome and demanding it, an ominous precedent that undermined his later attempts to restore the status quo, as if none of these things had happened. Mithridates had announced his war against Rome by ordering the massacre of Romans living in Asia, among them the publicani, or tax gatherers, 80,000 victims altogether, it was said, and then occupying mainland Greece. Sulla countered by sacking Athens, which had attracted this fate by its unwise support of Mithridates, though it is true that, with its plundering of the cultural capital of Greece after the destruction of Corinth and the reputation of the publicani, the Roman record in the Hellenic world could also do with some rehabilitation. Returning to Italy successful and rich in 83, Sulla was opposed by Marian partisans with levies of 100,000 men, which Sulla overcame, then marched on Rome for the second time and took it at the Battle of the Colline Gate, 82. Installed in power, Sulla initiated the first of the political vendettas styled proscriptions, a procedure, if it deserves the name, by which the names of his enemies were written up, proscripti, and displayed, which made them marked men. It was safe for anyone to kill them, which, these being prominent individuals, and this being a competitive society, many people had the motive to do. The procedure helped to settle old scores and enabled Sulla to dismember the opposition, also to enrich himself, as did the agents of the killing from confiscated properties. Sulla also removed the monuments commemorating Marius' victories in the Teutonic Wars, a petty gesture, were he not so afraid of his predecessor. He is said to have picked out the young Julius Caesar, entering his mid-teens at the time of Marius' death, as a Marian more dangerous than his model. Sulla was then given a dictatorship, in order to restore the constitution, a task which he addressed by reactionary legislation directed against the institutions of the people. This is not what the dictatorship was for, but it did respect the convention that it was a temporary office of 6 months only, bestowed in a crisis. Its most famous recipient was Quintus Fabius Maximus at the time of the Hannibalic War. None of his predecessors had used the office as a basis for political action, but Sulla used its powers, in the first instance to strengthen the Senate by the recruitment of his own supporters. By an extremely dubious maneuver, which had it lasted, would have retarded Rome's legal development by centuries, he also restored the Senate's authority, patrum auctoritas, over that of the Concilium Plebis, the People's Assembly, which, as explained earlier, had come into being soon after the foundation of the Republic. It need hardly be said that there was no such thing as patrum auctoritas, except in the minds of senators. But Sulla's reform asserted the authority of the Senate over plebiscites, which had since 267 BCE been recognized as a source of law, and over the people's magistrates, the tribunes. Sulla created new magistracies, 20 quaestors, to manage the provinces and to feed the Senate by recruitment. This was a reform of permanent importance, which we need to remember. The quaestorship continued to function as the magistracy that qualified aspiring young candidates for entry to the Senate. He established a 10-year gap between consulships and age limits for magistracies. This legislation, the so-called Lex Annalis, was the progenitor of the senatorial cursus honorum of the Principate. Sulla's legislation also prohibited tribunes from holding any higher senatorial office, a provision that would make the tribunate a dead end in the cursus, and was a transparent attempt to neutralize an office exercised in the interests of the people. Sulla left in place legislation about the citizenship. He had no wish to reopen the social wars. Having seen through his program of conservative reform, Sulla gave up the dictatorship and retired to Campania, from where he viewed affairs with ironic detachment and where he died of an illness in 78. Julius Caesar later remarked that Sulla did not know his political alphabet, as we might say, the political facts of life. It is unclear just what Caesar meant. Was it that once having acquired power, Sulla should have held on to it? Whether this is so or not, Sulla presented a problem for potential imitators. His example did not endorse his policies. To have seized Rome with armed force, to have conducted proscriptions, anyone challenging Sulla's policies could appeal to his methods. If Marius was rough-edged and clumsy, Sulla subtle and disconcerting, Pompey was unfathomable. Conservative and popular by turns, his political ambitions evade detection. The skeptical Tacitus described him, with long hindsight, as no better than his predecessors, though much more devious, occultior non melior. Naturally enough, since it was the scenario of his youth, Pompey's early career was tied up with Marius and Sulla, and with the history of Italy in the early 1st century. His father, C.N. Pompeius Strabo from Picenum in eastern Italy, had raised an army from his lands to help defeat the Italian allies in the social wars. Not to be outdone, we begin to see the scale of the resources available to these men. Young Pompey raised 3 legions from the same source to support Sulla on his return from the east in 83. He was 23 years old. Sulla rewarded him with appointments in Sicily and Africa. He conducted campaigns in both and was allowed to celebrate a triumph, an anomalous privilege since he was still only 25 years old and not yet even a senator. He had never been a quaestor, as Sulla's legislation required. From this still youthful moment, Pompey styled himself Magnus, the Great, which is how we know him. After Sulla's death, a radical ex-consul named Lepidus led an uprising to undo his legislation. Pompey helped to suppress the uprising, still acting in the senatorial against the popular interest, and in 77-71, he served in Spain against the rebel Q. Sertorius, a Marian supporter who had been proscribed by Sulla and established himself in Spain as a leader of local resistance. These years of absence represent a chance of pace in Pompey's rise, with experiences that may have helped to enlarge his perspectives. The campaigns in Spain were prolonged and difficult, and his time there enabled Pompey to build up a large network of patronage, a potential power base for future use. After the defeat of Sertorius, he returned to Italy with an army, cleverly timing his movements to join in Licinius Crassus' suppression of the slave revolt of Spartacus, and was elected consul with Crassus in 70. At 37 years old, he was still below the legal age for the consulship, set at 42 years in Sulla's legislation. As consul, he helped to undo Sulla's legislation on the tribunate. The law that achieved this was named Lex Pompeia Licinia, in the names of the consuls. Pompey's early career is opportunistic, if not technically illegal, but it reveals great natural ability and powers of leadership. And in Spain, where Roman policies had been notoriously violent, the capacity for clemency. Biding his time, perhaps, he did not take an overseas province after his consulship, but then two opportunities arose that changed the face of late Republican politics. By legislation proposed by a tribune, the Lex Gabinia of 67, Pompey was given a military command against the pirates who infested the Cilician coast in what is now southern Turkey. A glance at a relief map will show how piracy flourished in this region, with its inhospitable coastline, little hinterlands suitable for exploitation, and small harbors requiring local knowledge to navigate. Pompey took 3 months to report success. The task required intelligence, sustained attention, and coherence of command, qualities rarely to be found together in the late Republic, and there are lessons in all of them. It also required sufficient forces. Pompey was given 20 legions and 500 ships, an immense force for the task. The whole situation set the system at cross purposes. Acting under the authority of the law, Pompey would himself be expected to raise the forces, which once raised would be the forces of the res publica. But res publica would do nothing to finance them. There was no military budget, and when the task was done, it would be for Pompey to secure the land settlement and other benefits promised upon discharge. Was the army or was it not a public institution? The command against the pirates was followed in 66 by another law proposed by a tribune, the Lex Manilia, giving Pompey a 5-year command for a renewed war against Mithridates, whom he immediately defeated, and then directed his campaign against Mithridates' ally Tigranes of Armenia. The wide remit of the Lex Manilia, a 5-year proconsular imperium over the whole of Asia, enabled Pompey further to extend his influence. His comprehensive settlement set in order the eastern provinces, including Syria, which was annexed. In effect, the limit of Roman power was now at the river Euphrates in its northern sector, which does not mean that everything inside this frontier was securely held, nor that it was a formal frontier. Galatia and Cappadocia, Commagene, Judea, and Arabia remained under the control of kings friendly to Rome and loyal to her interests. As important as its scale is the structure of Pompey's command. The connection between military power, imperium, and magistracy, the length of the magistracy limiting the duration of imperium, is by now familiar. So too, the undesirability of extending imperium by repeating magistracies. The problem was solved by an imaginative but dangerous innovation. The giving of imperium, broadly defined in time and scope, described as proconsular, but without the need to hold the underlying magistracy. These grants of power are called extraordinaria imperia, in the strict sense of extraordinary, extraordinum, because they were outside the regular order of magistracies. Pompey's eastern settlement was a great and enduring achievement. He returned to Rome in 62 to general trepidation. What would he do with his army? Astonishingly to contemporaries, he disbanded it, returning it, one might say, to the people who had granted his powers. But his eastern settlement was not ratified by the Senate, nor would it provide for grants of land to Pompey's veterans. The Senate's refusal to carry out Pompey's promises led directly to his alliance with Julius Caesar, as is described in the following chapter. It is, however, worth noting the contrast in the careers of the two of them. Pompey with revolutionary beginnings, ending as champion of republicanism. Caesar overthrowing the Republic, but entirely regular in his earlier career, except perhaps in one respect, the scale of his debt. As to debt, we end with a famous episode of these years that draws together some of the themes that have arisen in the course of them, the Catilinarian conspiracy. L. Sergius Catilina, a noble from an ancient family, had stood for the consulship but repeatedly failed to be elected, and was defeated by the novus homo Cicero for the consulship of 63. He had fallen heavily into debt, which he had no way of repaying unless he were successful in winning office. He therefore endorsed a revolutionary program, at its center, the abolition of debt. Catiline had his own reasons, but the issue was a real one, with widespread rural debt, especially among discharged soldiers who had been unsuccessful on the land, as must have happened quite commonly. Catiline was accused of fomenting social disorder in Rome, and joined forces with the leader of a discontented army of veteran soldiers in Etruria, but was defeated leading them against a Roman general. Catiline was killed in the battle. His body was found on the battlefield, riddled with wounds, but not a single one in his back. In the final challenge, he died like a noble. The partisans of Catiline were tried by the Senate and executed under the authority of the Senatus Consultum Ultimum, one of the last and most notorious appearances of that disreputable institution. As presiding consul, Cicero had the executions carried out at once. "They have lived," he portentously announced to the Senate. In Cicero's own estimation, it was his finest hour, but he was later exiled for his part in it. Whatever the authority claimed for the Senatus Consultum Ultimum, it was illegal to execute Roman citizens without trial before the proper courts, and the Senate was not one of these. The story of this episode is narrated in two sources, Cicero's four orations against Catiline, and the historian Sallust's monograph on the conspiracy. Sallust presented the affair as a moral lesson, a patrician aristocrat turned bad, itself a reflection of Rome's moral decline, which went back to her overseas conquests in the second century, especially over Carthage and Corinth. This flooded Rome with wealth, and people were corrupted. It is a powerful, though hypocritical, presentation. Sallust himself was governor of Africa and accused of maladministration, only escaping because he was supported by his friend Caesar, whose role in the events of 63 he exaggerated, while in a fantastic act of animus, completely ignoring that of Cicero. But we must respect Sallust's diagnosis that the fabric of politics was affected by wealth pouring into Rome. It led to inflation and the cost of politics, to debt and bankruptcies. The people with the money could build up support by bailing out impoverished nobles, while the impoverished of all social ranks would follow anyone who could save them. Behind the events described in this chapter lie many questions that will require a solution in what follows. Who is it that rules Rome, and in what proportion among the social orders, as the Polybian balance of powers is upset? Is it the popular assemblies, technically sovereign and the makers of law, but subject to the manipulations of opportunistic politicians? Or is it the Senate, a birth and office-based aristocracy with pretensions to an authority and maturity of judgment based on its own assertions of these advantages? Is it the elected magistrates of the res publica? Or is it ambitious adventurers extracting unprecedented powers from the increasingly subservient institutions of the state? Need res publica necessarily mean a republican form of government? The institutional battles between the Senate and its magistrates and the tribunes, the people's champions, gave way to a different sort of conflict between res publica and individuals who, if they did not set their own ambitions above the common interests of Rome, took different views as to how those interests were best served. These men, we have seen, were styled the dynasts, dynastai, by Appian in the introduction to his History of the Civil Wars, a Greek term, with its Latin equivalent, potentes, the powerful, as used by Tacitus and others. Men who acquired power by stretching beyond their limits the legal constraints that had been established precisely to prevent this outcome. Yet any of these men, Marius or Sulla or Pompey, even Catiline, would have been offended to hear that they were driven entirely by private ambition, or that such ambition was an entirely personal matter. As in modern usage, the term has good and bad connotations. Proper ambition is laudable, justified by an array of virtues and behavior that spring from the public position of the ambitious and their families, whose dignity they are bound to uphold. Those virtues that sustain the upper-class Roman, pride in oneself, respect to one's equals, duty to one's colleagues and dependents, piety towards men and the gods, a true sense of family distinction, magnanimous generosity to the people, will also have him compete with his peers. And that, they would have said, is exactly how it should be. Chapter 2. The Tragedy of Julius Caesar. Cassius. How many ages hence shall this our lofty scene be acted over, in states unborn, and accents yet unknown? Brutus. How many times shall Caesar bleed in sport, that now on Pompey's basis lies along, no worthier than the dust? So does Shakespeare have his assassins wash their hands in Caesar's blood and greet their post-Caesarian dream world of liberty, freedom, and enfranchisement. Whether in Shakespeare or Plutarch, his source, it is an unassailably dramatic moment. Caesar's body, lying along with 23 stab wounds at the foot of the statue of his old adversary, the builder of the great theater where the deed was done. The Ides of March of the year 710, ab urbe condita, what we call the 15th of March, 44 BCE, is an emblematic moment. If ever there was a turning point in history, this is it. To see how it came about, we go back 12 years to a meeting of the dynasts Caesar, Pompey, and Crassus in the Tuscan city of Lucca. The so-called Conference of Lucca is a shadowy meeting, not only because it is not well attested in the historical sources, but because the three men who met there did so in order to divide up the Roman world, which being potentes, they had the power but no legal right to do. They are a strangely assorted group of men, gifted in different ways. What brought them together was debt. In the first place, Pompey owed Caesar. Pompey had returned to Rome in 62 after his great eastern conquests to general trepidation. What would he do with his army? Would he use it to march on Rome and seize power, as had been done before? Instead, as we have heard, Pompey disbanded his army, expecting no trouble in having his promises of discharge payments and land settlement met by the Senate. But it is a good question. Pompey's conquests were achieved under grants of imperium conveyed by public law. So was his army not the army of the res publica, and not Pompey's own to make promises to and to dispose of? To which it might be said that by now, half a century after Marius' new model army, this is how things were done, and that the question was, after all, before the Senate. But many senators seem to have asked it, for neither Pompey's organization of the eastern provinces nor the settlement of his veterans on lands promised them by their commander was ratified. The Senate's refusal led to an alliance of Pompey with Julius Caesar, who in 60 was elected consul for the following year, and used the office to support Pompey's settlement. In the second place, Caesar owed Pompey. After his consulship and the settlement of the Pompeian veterans, Caesar wanted a command in Gaul, through which he intended to match Pompey's victories in the east. Instead, the Senate gave him tracts and forests, cal silvaic, the policing of transhuman droveways in Italy. Such an assignment, conjured out of thin air, was nothing less than a deliberate insult to his dignity, which Caesar, as any Roman would, resented deeply. It was also a patent ploy to keep him out of the military command that would normally follow the consulship, and Caesar refused to accept it. It was now Pompey who secured for Caesar what he wanted, a command with proconsular power, imperium proconsulare, in Gaul. This was much more than the name implies. Gallia was a huge tract of land comprising the area of Celtic occupation in Italy beyond the river Po, the adjacent regions to the north and east, and the whole of Gaul proper, only the southernmost part of which, the original provincia, with its capital at Narbonne, was part of the Roman Empire as it then stood. In the third place, Caesar owed Crassus, in the most literal sense. He owed him money. M. Licinius Crassus had legendary wealth, from which Caesar had borrowed to stand for office. Campaign expenditure was not an issue at Rome, except that it created debt. In politics, a disinterested donor is the exception rather than the rule, and in consequence pressure for the abolition of debt. This was a revolutionary issue, as had been shown in the so-called Conspiracy of Catiline just a few years before. The meeting at Lucca marks a renewal of the so-called First Triumvirate, a compact between the three dynasts first formed in the year of Caesar's consulship. It should be made clear at once that the term triumvirate is a misnomer and is not found in contemporary usage. Unlike the members of the Second Triumvirate, Chapter 3, they were neither established nor understood as a formally established body of men commissioned by Senate and people to act under law for any publicly defined purpose. What they took from the meeting was something quite different, separate powers to further their own ambitions. Caesar's command in Gaul was extended for the 5 years 55 to 51 inclusive. He returned to Gaul and resumed his conquests. These campaigns, commemorated by Caesar in his commentaries, were the foundation of an enlarged Roman province of Gaul, and included an exploratory crossing to Britain, of which nothing came for the time being. Pompey was given a command in Spain, the province that was the scene of his earlier victories in the 70s. In the event, as was neither intended by the other triumvirs nor countenanced by the constitution, Pompey never went to Spain, but governed it through deputies, legati. Pompey himself continued to reside near Rome, from where he could influence metropolitan politics. He did not enter the city, for had he done so, by an ancient ordinance, the proconsular powers by which he governed Spain, appointed his legati, and commanded its armed forces, would revert to the serving consuls of the year, and he would be exposed to attack in the courts. With this technicality rectified, Pompey's device might provide a model for a future dynast confronted by the need to govern distant provinces and their armies without being personally present in them. Crassus was given a command in the east, resolving his debt to the others. He is the dark horse among the triumvirs, an immensely wealthy senator and financier of senators. He was the victor over the slave rebellion of Spartacus, and following this, Pompey's colleague in the consulship in 70, but with no serious military experience against a properly organized army. In the event, there was no need to worry about Crassus, who went off to the east but was defeated and killed by the Parthians in the wide Mesopotamian plains near Kerry, with the loss of his legionary standards, a humiliation not remedied for 35 years. The story was told of a performance of Euripides' Bacchae in the great Hellenistic city of Seleucia on the Tigris, in which the severed head of Crassus served as a stage prop for that of the dismembered king Pentheus. Crassus, like the wretched king, had dabbled in matters that he did not really understand. Another important point needs to be made clear. The dynasts meeting at Lucca could not simply give these powers to themselves. However distorted in the application, they were powers of the Republic, and had to be granted in a precisely defined form by the Roman Senate and people, revealing at once the extent of the control now exercised by the dynasts over the Senate and over the electoral process. Manipulation of the legal procedures that formed the Roman Constitution was rampant. Elections were rigged, and even though the candidates were still required to present themselves for election, magistracies could be promised years in advance and made part of deals between the dynasts. As to how this was achieved, the key word is clientela, the array of clients, of individuals and families who were connected with you. Tenants on your estates, friends of the family, relations by marriage, army officers who had served under you, recipients of benefactions, freed slaves, people in your debt and generally beholden to you. Also, in the broadest sense, people who appreciated the public games and other benefits you had given, that is to say, the people of Rome. The theater of Pompey, in which Caesar was assassinated, was itself an expression of Pompey's clientela among the people of Rome. One duty of a client was to turn out to vote for his patron, and it was an act of disloyalty, what Romans called impiety, not to do so. Underlying the whole system is wealth. Clientelae were extended, and elections won by massive spending, hence the political importance of Crassus, and even after his election to the consulship, of Caesar's dependence on him. Another technical point concerns the procedures of the electoral system. The tribes, or voting constituencies, did not cast their votes simultaneously, but in order of seniority until a majority was secured, at which point the voting ceased. A consequence of this procedure was that voting patterns set early in the process would tend to be reinforced as it advanced, and electors casting their votes later in the process would tend to follow the consensus as it emerged. Further, the vote was taken in the order of the propertied classes, since the richer centuries were called first, and the older Roman tribes were favored over the more recent. The system was biased towards the higher propertied levels, and towards Romans as opposed to Italians. Indeed, many electors had become so used to seeing their votes not called for that they ceased to turn up at all. It was not necessary to buy the entire system in order to influence it, just enough to deliver the majority, in the lopsided fashion just described. The death of Crassus at Kerry left Pompey and Caesar face to face. Pompey in his constitutional capsule near Rome, and Caesar and his army at large in Gaul. As his 5-year imperium drew to an end, Caesar was frustrated by the machinations of Pompey and the Senate, who devised legal obstacles to his design of returning to Rome to stand for the consulship that he expected when the Gallic command expired. Despite a popular decree, moved by the tribunes to allow him to do so, the Senate and Pompey refused him permission to stand for the office in absence, a damaging blow to Caesar's prospects, for if he came to Rome to offer himself as a candidate, it would be as a private citizen, exposed to the risk of legal challenge. This would disqualify his candidature, since those standing for office had to certify that they were not defendants in a legal action while the election was conducted. So we come to the crossing of the Rubicon, Il Rubicone, a small river passing under the road, the ancient Via Emilia, south of Rimini. However unimposing, the Rubicon is critically important, since it was the border between Italy and Cisalpine Gaul. In crossing it, Caesar had led an army outside his province, an illegal act under the terms of the Lex Maiestasis of Sulla, and in entering Italy, he had come within the competence of the consuls, rendering his imperium void. For was not imperium proconsulari held on behalf of the consuls? It is a declaration of civil war, for which Caesar's justification was that his dignitas required it. As we have already seen, this is not just a matter of personal pride, but of the standing of a Roman in his community and among his peers. Dignitas, what one is worth, touches the whole question of one's valuation in Roman society. Shakespeare brilliantly picks up the point in Brutus' phrase, cited in the epigraph to this chapter. No worthier than the dust. Caesar's worthiness, being a matter of how he was perceived, was a non-negotiable entity that justified his action. The mere fact that he had broken the law, and that his action was likely to cause the death of thousands in civil war, were subsidiary issues. Instead of facing Caesar in Italy, Pompey withdrew to Thessaly with his supporters to prepare his defense there. One of these supporters, and there were many who chose this option, was the speaker of the so-called Laudatio Turiae, translated in Volume 2, Chapter 2, a senator who left Italy, leaving his property interests to be defended by his womenfolk. In response to Pompey's withdrawal, Caesar did not hurry to Thessaly, but went to Spain instead. It is an illustration of his superior insight. Spain, where Pompey had a great clientela from his service there back in the 70s, was a heartland of Pompeian influence. Caesar's first move was to strike first by undercutting Pompeian support in the west. However, he still had to fight Pompey, and did so at the Battle of Pharsalus in Thessaly in 48. The battle after which, surveying the carnage, Caesar shifted the blame to his opponents in his declaration, Hoc valuerunt, this is what they wanted. Pompey fell back to Egypt to reorganize, but was pitifully murdered on landing by the agents of young King Ptolemy, then engaged in a struggle for the throne of Egypt with his sister Cleopatra. Caesar followed Pompey, entered Alexandria, and in a notably adventuresome interlude, supported Cleopatra in her struggle with Ptolemy. His predictable, and from her point of view, entirely rational affair with Cleopatra produced a baby son, named Ptolemy Caesar, less formally Caesarion, a Greek diminutive, Little Caesar. Leaving Cleopatra and Caesarion for the time being in Alexandria, Caesar then returned to Italy by way of Syria and Asia Minor, again striking at the heart of Pompeian influence in the east. It was later, in commemorating the Battle of Zela in his triumphal procession at Rome, that Caesar displayed the famous legend, Veni, Vidi, Vici, I came, I saw, I conquered. The words were displayed on placards advertising his victory, and not, as is so often assumed in order to illustrate the pronunciation of the letter V spoken by Caesar after the battle. The Pompeian party regrouped, but was defeated by Caesar at Thapsus in Africa in 46 and at Munda in Spain in 45. The civil wars are over. Caesar seems irresistible. What will he do next? In considering this astonishing man, we should bear three things in mind. First, his military campaigns, both in Gaul and in the civil wars, were startlingly brilliant. They are much in favor among connoisseurs of military history. By originality of thinking and speed of action, Caesar could deploy in various theaters and throw down challenges where they were not expected, and he was able to accomplish the coordination to sustain the originality. The civil wars of 48 to 45 encompassed the whole Roman world as it then stood, Italy to Spain, back to Thessaly, on to Alexandria, Syria, Asia, and Africa, back to Spain, and again to Italy, all in the space of 4 years. Considering ancient conditions of travel, when an army is pressed to maintain 15 miles a day, and the pre-imperial road systems then in use, it is an amazing performance. The danger for Caesar himself, perhaps, was in establishing a level of psychological excitement that would be difficult to sustain in calmer times. Second, Caesar was famous for his clementia, an ability to forgive and let bygones be bygones. It is not simply, and perhaps not at all, that he was kind-hearted, as if this were at all relevant, for clementia was as much a public as a private virtue. Caesar was a pragmatist, recognizing that in times of civil war, people may choose the wrong side through no fault of their own. He offered terms of alliance, took in enemies, and gave them advancement, even though it did not always work, sometimes requiring a more genuine change of mind than they were prepared to offer, which is to say that they were prepared to exploit the clemency. In the best-known instance, Cassius and Brutus, Pompeian supporters at Pharsalus, were received by Caesar after the battle and forgiven. They both held office as praetor in 44 and were among Caesar's assassins. Third, there is the control of what counted as the media. Caesar's commentaries presented the Gallic and civil wars in the form of unvarnished accounts of the truth, the cleverest form of propaganda. Crisp and lucid in style, factual both in substance and in appearance, as his readers notice at once, Caesar presents himself in the third person throughout. The commentaries bear all the formal signs of objectivity. There is, however, at least one startling omission. In the Civil War, Caesar contrives not to mention the name of the River Rubicon. A classic account of Caesar's skill in presentation is built upon the theme of historical deformation. M. Rambo's L'Art de la Déformation Historique dans les Commentaires de César. It does not mean that one cannot take his side. It was, after all, Pompey who was the more famous for deviousness. As a contemporary wrote, rather unkindly, Pompey is apt to say one thing and think another, but not clever enough to keep his real aims from showing. It is a different matter to confront Caesar with the Roman Constitution. He faces an old problem: how to express and how to accept greater imperium for longer periods and over larger territories than the republican magistracies allowed. In Caesar's case, the issue was supreme power, which was already his de facto, but was a power which the magistracies were designed to prevent by time limits, by collegiate tenure, and by the possession of veto by colleagues. It is revealing to observe how Caesar addressed this problem. There is, first, the question of the consulship, the highest republican magistracy. Caesar held it on 5 occasions, in 59, then in 48, 46, 45, and 44, the year of his assassination. This is hardly satisfactory. There were only two consulships. It was the highest office for the nobility, which others, too, expected to hold, and it was not supposed to be held in sequence. To pass directly from one magistracy to another removed the interval for the legal review of conduct in office, an essential constraint in the republican system. Caesar's continuous tenures left these issues unresolved, if it did not ignore them completely. There was the dictatorship, an ancient republican office intended for use only in extreme crises, and tenable for 6 months only. With startling effrontery, Caesar held the dictatorship in 49 for the purpose of holding elections after the departure of Pompey for Thessaly, thereby securing his own election as consul for 48, at which point he resigned the dictatorship. It is an unusual conception of a crisis affecting the res publica, though it does respect the time limit attaching to the office. 2 years later, however, Caesar had himself appointed dictator for 10 years, and in 44, perpetual dictator, dictator perpetual. These arrangements were in blatant contradiction of republican precedent. In fact, in 46, 45, and 44, Caesar was both consul and dictator, an accumulation of powers never imagined under the Republic. Caesar's contemporaries, as contemporaries often do, had to get used to what had not previously been imagined, but there were limits. In all, Caesar's clarity of vision does not seem to extend to the Roman Constitution, perhaps because he was too pragmatic to give it much attention, or thought it genuinely unimportant. His legal power is constitutionally rather ramshackle and has an improvisatory air, a bit of this, that, and the other. Perhaps this was inevitable if the Constitution failed to encompass the power that he thought necessary. How within the Constitution could one conceive of reforming it? In all other respects, Caesar's achievement has a particular imprint of genius, in that it encompassed the detail as well as the grand design. In this he anticipates Augustus, to whom we shall come, and another hyper-intelligent and inventive king, Peter the Great. In a way, as Falstaff's wit was the cause of wit in others, Caesar's failure measures his contemporaries' lack of imagination. Caesar was not killed because, from a selection recorded by his biographer Suetonius, he reformed the calendar, or appointed a chief librarian at Rome, the great antiquarian scholar Varro, or organized censuses more efficiently, or attempted a codification of Roman law, or even because he extended the citizenship, all excellent and desirable policies. More important than any of this was his attitude to honors, and his gestures of power in relation to the public at whom they were directed. It was not so much what Caesar was, as what he seemed to be. How it was perceived. The key lies in the honors that he accumulated from those who did not care much about the Roman Constitution, in the eyes of those who did care. He received wreaths, titles, and honorific decrees, and he indulged in gestures of self-presentation, which the public was free to interpret as it saw them. An example. He promoted the cult of Venus Genitrix, from whom he claimed that his family, the Julii, was descended. In Virgil's Aeneid, Aeneas is the son of Anchises and Venus, and his own son is called Iulus. The image of Aeneas, Anchises, and little Iulus escaping from Troy appears on a Caesarian coin, long before Virgil came to it. It did not end here, for he invited, or summoned, Cleopatra to Rome, with little Caesarian, and put up a statue of her in the temple. What was the Roman public supposed to make of this? Was Cleopatra the genitrix, and Caesar descended from Aeneas, the progenitor through Caesarion, of a new Roman race? If so, then perhaps the progenitor also of a new political system. Was he then planning a great Hellenistic monarchy of East and West, with himself and Cleopatra at its head? Not such a bad idea, it might seem. No one could argue that the parochial republic had much to offer, so perhaps a transplanted Hellenistic kingdom, if one could accept the idea of kingship, was a viable alternative. These are ideas such as a writer like Tacitus might attribute to an anonymous Roman public, as he does in the case of Augustus. More specifically, Caesar was observed to receive foreign embassies personally, as if he were a king. By settled convention, embassies were received by the Senate as part of its claims to authority in foreign affairs. And lastly, on a famous occasion, emphasized by Plutarch and dramatized by Shakespeare, there was his refusal of the offer of a crown by his fellow consul, Marcus Antonius. This was on the occasion of the festival of the Lupercalia, in mid-February of 44. It was what would now be called a trial balloon, to see what people thought of the gesture, under the cover provided by a ribald celebration at which normal forms of behavior and social conventions were loosened. It was no particular moment or issue, but the accumulation of powers and actions and their interpretations of these actions that alienated some senators, and their sense of not knowing where it would stop. So we come to the Ides of March, a month after the episode at the Lupercalia, when Caesar was assassinated, just a few days before he was to set out on a Parthian campaign to recover the unavenged standards of Crassus. We should think ourselves into the mind of the conspirators. What if Caesar returns victorious from Parthia, brandishing the recovered standards, reuniting with Cleopatra, and raising further the prospect of a Hellenistic monarchy? He is about to leave Rome, possibly for an extended period, with a large army that would certainly support him and Antonius, consul in his absence. This would make him irresistible. The conspirators do not want this challenge, and time is short. The watchword was Libertas. The assassins were the liberators. But liberators from what? The complaints boil down to one fear: a restoration of the monarchy that the Republic was designed to prevent. It is a narrow cause of fear, reflecting the ideals of a particular class rather than a general sentiment. What is liberty but the preservation of senatorial prerogatives, much as the Republic itself had claimed them after the overthrow of the monarchy? There is no sign that the common people much minded the idea of monarchy, and they certainly did not mind Caesar. The occasion, as described earlier, was in a room by the theater of Pompey, where the Senate was about to meet. To the end, Caesar retained his dignity, in our as well as the Roman sense of the word, covering his face and legs so as to die decent and with his features hidden. It was a Roman moment, to compare with the death of Catiline in 63, the rebellious senator who died in battle against Rome, but took every blow facing the enemy. The body was left where it lay, as the Senate scattered in panic, and was later taken home by three of Caesar's household slaves. A doctor who then examined it pronounced that of the 23 wounds inflicted on Caesar, only the second, falling on his breast, was mortal. It seems incredible, unless they really did not want to kill him, or perhaps having started, they lost heart. One can imagine them stabbing the dying man one by one, their enthusiasm for the task fading as they took their turn. There is even a suggestion that Caesar invited it. He dismissed his bodyguard, he ignored warnings. "Beware the Ides of March," says the soothsayer in Julius Caesar, deriving from Plutarch's biography, Rome was no place for secrets, and Caesar must have known that something was in the air. Perhaps with his health weakening and his famous energy disappearing with the years, he was wary and not relishing the future. Also, contempt for the ineffective republic. We may be attracted by the provocative notion of Ronald Syme that Caesar throve on competition and risk, but had changed the rules to eliminate them and was bored by the result. He was not as driven as he had been, the chances of greater success than he had so far enjoyed seeming more and more distant. Both Plutarch and Suetonius have a famous story, that on the night before his murder, Caesar was dining with friends, dealing with correspondence while they talked among themselves. They raised the question, what was the best sort of death? Sudden and unexpected, said Caesar, before anyone else could speak. The story may have been made up for the occasion, but the remark is in character, and there were many who would remember the moment. Shakespeare's version of the scene following Caesar's murder includes Mark Antony's famous Friends, Romans, Countrymen address to the people. But what actually happened was less elaborate. Antony had a herald read out a decree in which the Senate had voted Caesar all human and divine honors, together with an oath to defend him against all dangers, adding just a few words himself. The decree spoke for itself. The Senate knew that there were dangers, and it had not kept its oath. The crowd tried to burn the houses of Brutus and Cassius, but were repelled. On the way, some of them encountered and killed a man called Cinna, whom they thought had criticized Caesar, mounted his head on a pole, and carried it round the city. But it was the wrong man. They had caught Helvius, not Cornelius Cinna. Cinna the poet, not Cinna the liberator. Shakespeare uses the encounter to add some dark humor and to suggest the confusion at the heart of the tragic sweep of events. Helvius Cinna explains to the rampaging plebeians that he is on his way to Caesar's funeral, but they are not satisfied. First plebeian, as a friend or an enemy? Cinna, as a friend. Second plebeian, that matter is answered directly. Fourth plebeian, for your dwelling, briefly. Cinna, briefly, I dwell by the capital. Third plebeian, your name, sir, truly? Cinna, truly, my name is Cinna. First plebeian, tear him to pieces, he's a conspirator. Cinna, I am Cinna the poet, I am Cinna the poet. Fourth plebeian, tear him for his bad verses. Tear him for his bad verses. A literary challenge within the action, from Shakespeare the poet. It was an obvious irony that Caesar fell at the feet of a statue of Pompey, the dictator at the feet of his former colleague and rival. A theatrical moment, in a portico of Pompey's theater. And now some street theater, as Caesar's funeral was held in the Campus Martius. The people came in huge numbers with their gifts. All streets were open, and no social distinctions were or could be enforced, as the whole crowd mixed together. Some words of the ancient playwright Pacuvius were recited. Did I save these men that they might be those to kill me? Words understood and clearly intended as an allusion to Brutus and Cassius, pardoned after Pharsalus, and now among Caesar's assassins. Then, in a touch of the supernatural, easily staged, two strange beings lit the funeral pyre. Everyone surged forward and threw on it everything they could. Torn branches, seats, clothing, anything they could carry. The conspirators realized how badly they had misjudged the reaction that would follow Caesar's murder, and left Rome for their own safety, leaving the stage to the consul Mark Antony, Caesar's deputy as dictator, the magister equitum Lepidus, and to Caesar's heir. But who would this be? Chapter 3. Caesar's Heir. At the age of 19, upon my own initiative and at my own expense, I raised an army through which I vindicated the liberty of a republic oppressed by the dominance of a faction. Augustus, Res Gestae. The response of Caesar's supporter, Mark Antony, Marcus Antonius, to these tumultuous events was conciliatory, in true Caesarian fashion. He even extended an amnesty to the conspirators. A long-term friend and ally, who had been with Caesar in Gaul, as tribune had defended his interests at Rome and commanded the left wing at Pharsalus, Antonius was Caesar's colleague in the latter's fifth and final consulship, which would make him the senior magistrate at Rome during Caesar's planned absence in Parthia. If Caesar were a king, Antonius would be his viceroy. Brutus and Cassius left Rome, and in a particularly nice touch, were given formal exemption from their duties as praetors. The dictatorship was abolished. When we imagine what it might have contained, Caesar's will is surprising in its orthodoxy. He left 300 sesterces, a nice windfall, to every Roman citizen, and to the people at large, his Tiber Gardens for use as a park. To go to the heart of the issue, however, we need to know a little more about Roman testamentary procedure. We may begin with the distinction between legacies to named beneficiaries, such as the Roman people, and essential to the validity of a will, the appointment of heirs to the estate. In Roman law, as in common sense, a deceased person cannot act. What a testator can do is express his intentions while living and entrust his heirs to carry them out as matters of good faith, fidei committere, after his death, as well as accept any financial or other obligations that have accrued to the estate. The role of the heirs, who may be named in various degrees to different portions of the estate, is critical. It is an honorable and responsible duty. The heir in the first degree to Caesar's estate, and to the obligations that went with it, was his great-nephew, C. Octavius. In the end, it was family that counted. Caesar had no legitimate son. Caesarion, his son by Cleopatra, was not from a Roman marriage, and in Roman law could not inherit. Of two great nephews, one was unimportant, the other was Octavius. He was the grandson of Caesar's sister Atia, and son of C. Octavius of Velitrae, the first senator in his family, and he had impressed Caesar during his campaign against the Pompeians in Spain. Octavius was not yet 19 years old at the time of Caesar's death. He was born on the 23rd of September, 63 BCE, and was not in Rome, but in the city of Apollonia in Epirus, for what some call his education. However, Apollonia was not just a university town, but strategically important, as had already been shown in the civil wars. It stood at the western end of the Via Egnatia, across Macedonia, along which Caesar would march on his way to Parthia. Octavius was clearly intended to interrupt his studies to join Caesar when he crossed the Adriatic Sea to begin the campaign, which Caesar would use to groom him for whatever future plans he had in mind. Another provision of the will now comes into play, and another point of Roman law. Octavius was appointed heir in the first degree on condition that he adopt Caesar's name for himself and his own descendants. The procedure is often called testamentary adoption, though it is not quite this, but a condition in the appointment as heir. As just mentioned, a deceased person cannot perform any action, and that includes the adoption of a son. In practice, it had the same effect as an adoption, and was often used by testators to achieve it. It is important to be absolutely clear on one matter. There was no way in which Octavius could inherit Caesar's public position as vested in his offices of state. No one could bequeath a Roman magistracy bestowed by due process of law, even one as closely connected with Julius Caesar as the dictatorship. However irregular the office and the procedure that had led to it, the dictatorship had been bestowed by public authority and lapsed with Caesar's death. Octavius could inherit fortune and the name and the goodwill that came with it, what the Romans called clientela, that is to say, he could inherit the foundations of political power, but not the power itself. This, if he wanted it, he would have to win it for himself. The point of Roman law that now arises is that a person who is appointed as heir in a testament is given a set period, usually 60 or 100 days, in which he may accept the appointment and claim title to the estate, but it is not obligatory to accept it. As well as its assets, an estate will normally contain duties to carry out as fidei commissa, as well as debts and other liabilities. For this reason, it was usual to appoint substitute heirs in case those of first choice were to decline. At this point, the question, what would Octavius do when he learned of his appointment, must have been in many people's minds, including those close to him. Some friends tried to dissuade him from accepting, but this was an unthinkable option. And in late April, 6 weeks after the Ides of March, well within the time limit allowed by law, Octavius arrived at Rome to claim the inheritance. He had crossed from Apollonia to Brundisium, landing outside the town rather than in the harbor, where his arrival could have been anticipated. He probably had in mind the precedent of Pompey, who had stepped ashore in Egypt to be killed by the agents of young King Ptolemy. There were now two stages of legal procedure to be accomplished. The first was to present oneself to the urban praetor and declare willingness to accept appointment as an heir. This is the procedure known as cretio, from the verb cernere, resolve, declare. And it of course entailed Octavian's formal acceptance of the terms laid down in Caesar's will. The second stage, in later law the two were combined, was to petition for authority to enter into actual possession of the estate, the process known as petitio bonorum, and Octavian duly proceeded to this stage. This application also was made to the praetor, apparently with success, but Octavian's claim to enter into the estate was obstructed by the consul, Mark Antony, on the technical but legally well-informed grounds that his adoption into the Caesarian family had not been formally ratified by an appropriate resolution of the people, a lex curiata. This plan backfired, however, when Octavius paid Caesar's bequest to the people from his own resources, assuming that he would get the money later. Nothing could have been better calculated to enhance the standing with the people of this still relatively unknown young man. From now, under the terms of his appointment as Caesar's heir, Octavius is known as C. Julius Caesar, sometimes also with the name Octavianus, which is how we know him in this next stage of his career. There was also that novel element in Octavian's nomenclature. He was Divi Filius, the son of the divine Caesar. The claim may seem startling to modern eyes, but to the attuned Roman mind, attuned, that is, to the political mood as well as to matters concerning the gods, it was a statement of fact. Caesar was divine, and Octavian was his son. Despite his youth, Octavian is already the most formidable of the contenders for Caesar's political position. The contrast of personalities between him and Antonius is striking, as is perhaps most familiar to us from Shakespeare's Antony and Cleopatra, an authentic view, as taken over from Plutarch, with the addition of Shakespeare's psychological insight. Octavian is much younger. He is about to turn 19, Antony around 40. Antony is convivial, volatile, with an infectious humor and turns of temper. Octavian is cool, controlled, calculating. Antony is a romantic hero with a tendency to extremes of behavior and capable of a grand passion, as is hardly imaginable of Octavian. A comparison with Virgil's Aeneas is irresistible. Overtaken by passion for Dido, he yet obeys the god and, in an act of pietas, leaves his foreign queen for a greater, though more laborious, destiny. One may appeal to Plutarch and Shakespeare for a story of grand passion ending in tragedy, but these people were playing with the Roman world. Tens of thousands of lives were at stake, and it was the unromantic Octavian who changed the world. Historians have never forgiven him for his cool and unromantic nature, but he is a fascinating figure, a personal mystery, a colossal achievement. The image he bore on his signet ring was the Sphinx. Octavian's early methods were no prettier than we would expect, their ugliness somewhat exaggerated by the contrast with his self-construction as the pious princeps of later years. In fostering this later reputation, the mature Augustus invited ironic contrast with his early career, but one can hardly say that he was worse than the others. He was clever, ruthless, and devious when necessary, and next to impossible to outmaneuver. There were many people out to do him harm. For a time after his arrival in Italy as Caesar's heir, Octavian allowed himself to be enrolled in the senatorial cause against Antonius. Early in 43, he led a military force raised by himself, as he explains in his own later account of these transactions, to North Italy, where the city of Modena, had been occupied by the liberators and was under siege from Antonius. With his private force, consisting largely of Caesarian veterans loyal to the family name, Octavian was to reinforce the army sent by the Senate under the consuls of the year, C. Pansa and A. Hirtius, to relieve the siege in favor of the liberators. Antonius withdrew from the city before Octavian's advance, but not before one of the consuls had been mortally wounded and his colleague killed in skirmishes against the Antonians. Assuming command of the entire army, Octavian then marched on Rome, canceled the amnesty for the liberators, and joined Antonius. However breathtaking, it was not an unpredictable outcome. Caesar's heir could not seriously have been expected to stay with the party of the liberators. Antonius and Octavian, together with M. Aemilius Lepidus, formerly Caesar's Master of the Horse, the ancient title of a dictator's deputy, now regrouped to form what we know as the Second Triumvirate. Unlike the First Triumvirate, the reclusive arrangement made between Caesar, Pompey, and Crassus in 56, this was a properly established institution founded in public law. The Lex Titia passed by the popular assembly on the 27th of November, 43. By the terms of the law, the triumvirs were appointed with full consular powers and the right to appoint magistrates to set in order the res publica. The commission to restore the Republic was empowered by the Republic. It was the same formulation as earlier used by the dictator Sulla to institute conservative reforms. It was a matter of opinion what one thought res publica to be and what was necessary to restore it. It was also a matter of opinion what actions would be permissible in the interests of setting the res publica in order, as became clear at once when the triumvirs instituted or reinstituted the proscriptions. As we heard in Chapter 1, this was a procedure by which enemies of the Republic, that is to say, opponents of the triumvirs, were marked for destruction and their property for confiscation by the posting up of their names in a public place. In effect, it meant that anyone could take the life of a proscribed person without fear of legal action. A chilling scene of Shakespeare's Julius Caesar portrays the process, with the trading of names between the triumvirs for what were purely personal reasons. A notable victim among many Even the antiquarian and scholar Varro was proscribed, to be protected by a friend. Was the orator, and especially in his own estimation, statesman Cicero? In the early 50s, Cicero had promoted the idea of a concord of the orders, concordia ordinum, a harmonious alliance of the orders of Rome, Senate, equestrians, people, under the moral leadership of a princeps. Cicero imagined Pompey in this role, and himself as Pompey's advisor. So he supported Pompey against Caesar in the early 50s, but had to eat his words when they banded together in 56. Cicero withdrew from the scene with the growth of Caesar's power and the eclipse of Pompey, and in consolation for political failure, devoted himself to philosophy. In an extraordinary sequence of works written in this period, De Oratore, De Republica, De Officiis, De Legibus, Tusculan Disputations, De Divinatione, and others, Cicero discussed the idea of statehood and public life in a tradition of Greek philosophy and with Greek sources, but in Roman fashion. These works, which must have been composed very fast, had an immense impact on late antique, medieval, and Renaissance culture, and preserve much later Greek philosophy, otherwise lost, as well as a wealth of information about Roman public life and religious practice. It is easy to be offended by Cicero's vanity and patronizing about his political ambitions, but he is a most formidable figure. Cicero was not among the liberators, but he was overjoyed at Caesar's murder, and whether with great courage or manic foolhardiness, attacked Antonius in a sequence of orations in the Senate, known as Philippics, after Demosthenes' attacks on Philip of Macedon in the 4th century BCE. In these speeches, he painted Antonius as an immoral reprobate and prospective tyrant, and he tried to enroll Octavian against him. The idea was to use Octavian in the senatorial interest, then get rid of him. The young man is to be praised, courted, and dispensed with, a statement attributed to Cicero, is perhaps just ben trovato, though it is contemporary, and may reflect what was known of Cicero's position. It was a devious plan, and fell to a more clear-sighted deviousness. Octavian was not the naive youth that Cicero imagined, and he agreed to Antonius' demand that Cicero be proscribed. Cicero could perhaps have escaped, as some did, but confronted with the failure of his political dreams, seems not to have tried very hard, and offered himself to his killers when they caught up with him. He was killed on the 7th of December, 43, 20 years almost to the day from his own illegal execution of the Catilinarian conspirators, the day of his greatest pride. With the death of Cicero, Antonius was freed from an outspoken critic, Octavian from an unreliable supporter, and Octavian's hands were clean, since he could blame Antonius. The development of Octavian's position, the elimination of his rivals, and his emergence as first princeps of Rome, are summarized in his remarkable memoir known to us as the Res Gestae, erected at his mausoleum and in provincial cities after his death. Here, too, one can see the Caesarian inheritance. In its unadorned style, the text resembles the famous commentaries of his adoptive father, with the difference that its author, unlike Caesar, expressed himself in the narrative first person. A mausoleum is no place for modesty. It is also, despite its literal truth in the detail, a deeply misleading account of its author's achievements. In the Res Gestae, Augustus traced and in the process justified his rise to power in its successive phases, which he is careful not to describe as a single process, as if to demonstrate that the outcome was not one he had planned from the beginning, but was thrust upon him by circumstance and the wickedness of others. First, at the age of 19, raising an army at his own initiative and from his own resources, He liberated the res publica from the domination of a faction, the liberators, in response to which he was made a senator and given rights to speak equal to those of an ex-consul, a category of senators enjoying the highest priority in senatorial procedure after the currently serving consuls. Appointed consul after the deaths of Hirtius and Pansa, he was then appointed a member of the triumvirate to set in order the res publica by the lex titia. He avenged his adoptive father's murder by driving the killers into exile in what he claims was due legal process, and then defeating them at the Battle of Philippi in 42. In a later passage, he describes how he made the sea peaceful by clearing it of pirates, a neat recasting of the truth about Sextus Pompeius. Pompeius, son of Pompey the Great, was the leader of a powerful maritime empire based in southern Italy and Sicily, a seriously underrated figure in the events of this period. Pompeius controlled the central Mediterranean and the east-west communications that it carried, and he could threaten the grain supply of Rome. Having defeated Pompeius at the Battle of Naulochos off the coast of Sicily in 36, Octavian overcame Antony and Cleopatra, who are not named, in the war fought at Actium. Only in the next paragraph does he say how he added Egypt to the Imperium Romanum, as if it were nothing to do with the civil war. The Res Gestae is an essay in deconstruction. Most of these activities were, or could be argued to be, based on Octavian's legal position as set out in the Lex Titia. The war against Antony and Cleopatra, however, was fought on the basis of a different sort of authority, an oath of all Italy sworn to Octavian and repeated by the provinces of Gaul, Spain, Africa, Sicily, and Sardinia. To understand this, we need to discuss the development of Octavian's legal powers. The triumviral powers given by the Lex Titia ran for 5 years, from the beginning of 42 to the end of 38. By agreement among the triumvirs, Antonius took on the reorganization of the East, including campaigns against Parthia. Behind this, and the planned campaign of Caesar in 44, lay the question of the standards lost by Crassus at the Battle of Carrhae in 54. In 41, Antony met Cleopatra, who came on her great royal barge to see him at Tarsus, began his affair with her, and traveled with her to Egypt. Cleopatra bore him twins in 40. The triumvirate was renewed, again by law, for a further 5 years from the beginning of 37 to the end of 33. Antony returned to the East and had another son by Cleopatra, leaving Octavian and Lepidus to manage affairs in the West. After the Battle of Naulochos, Lepidus forced a showdown with Octavian before the legions, but misjudged badly when the legions opted for Octavian. Seizing the advantage, Octavian was able to spare Lepidus' life and dispense with him, the end of a famous Caesarian. In effect, though not in law, this reduced the triumvirate to two. In 32, with the expiry of the renewed Lex Titia, there ensued a vacancy in the powers of the triumvirs. This did not matter to Antony, now the de facto ruler with Cleopatra of a great Hellenistic kingdom in the East. But it did matter in the West, with its different political and more legalistic traditions. The vacancy in Octavian's power was filled, quite audaciously, by the oath sworn, according to the Res Gestae, in spontaneous sentiment by the whole of Italy, and after it the named provinces, demanding that he be their leader in the war in which I was victorious at Actium. Nowhere in the Res Gestae does Augustus actually name his enemies. We can imagine the decrees and embassies pouring in from the cities of Italy, no doubt with offers of financial help to back up their oath. It was in no way a legitimate source of imperium, and we are left to judge for ourselves how spontaneous the decrees and embassies really were. But Octavian claimed the oath as giving him authority. He has no powers, but the people demand his leadership. The authors of a coup d'état often make such a claim. The war against Antony and Cleopatra took place in 31 in western Greece, and it was an untidy affair. The position of the opposing land armies, face to face over a narrow entrance to a large lagoon, was anomalous. To force an engagement, either both armies would have to march round to the far end of the lagoon and meet there, or one army, at great disadvantage to itself, cross over the strait to face the other. Neither of these maneuvers seemed likely to happen. After some time in this stalemate, during which a number of Antony's supporters defected to Octavian over the short passage across the strait, the two sides met in a naval engagement off the Cape of Actium. By textbook standards, it was not much of a battle, and it is unclear what happened, except that before the fleets had seriously engaged, Cleopatra withdrew her ships from the line and sailed away towards Alexandria, and Antonius followed, his mind in a state of black depression memorably described by Plutarch. Whether it was a tactical ploy that did not work, or an attempt to deny Octavian the battle and regroup at Alexandria, or whether Cleopatra was abandoning Antonius as a lost cause, these questions were asked at the time and have been ever since. Whatever the explanation, in the following year, Octavian followed them to Egypt and defeated Antonius in battle, after which Antonius joined Cleopatra in suicide. The narrative of these events in Plutarch's Life of Antony, followed by Shakespeare in Antony and Cleopatra, is a classic story of high romance and a beautiful piece of writing. We may also recall Virgil's description in Book 8 of the Aeneid, where the Battle of Actium is described prophetically as the culminating scene on the shield made by Vulcan for Aeneas. Every reader of Virgil would compare the suicide of Cleopatra with that of Dido when Aeneas had left her, renouncing his foreign queen. No one could avoid the parallel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.